Welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. It is our pleasure, Deborah and mine, once again to welcome you into our home for our portions of worship today. We will be celebrating the sacrament together, so if you'd like to participate in the sacrament, please prepare for yourselves the elements of Holy Communion. Bread, cracker, wafer, something for the first element, and wine, grape juice, or water for the second element. We've had three birthdays in our congregation this past week. Yesterday, Saturday, it was Zachary Officer's birthday. And today, Sunday, is Diane Jewell's birthday and Jean Rasmussen's birthday. So happy birthday to you all, and let us sing for you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Congratulations, friends. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship.
Thank you. us confess our faith in the God who calls us into what lies ahead. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you.
pray together the prayer of the day. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. I will be reading this from a different translation from the one that you have in your bulletin or on the screen. Did you not know? Have you not heard? Was it not told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? Yahweh sits above the vaulted roof of the world, and its inhabitants look like grasshoppers. God stretches out the skies like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent for mortals to live under. God reduces the privileged to nothing and throws the rulers of the earth into chaos. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root on earth than God blows on them and they wither, and a storm wind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom can you liken me? Who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes and ask yourself, who made these stars, if not the one who drills them like an army, calling each by name? Because God is so great in strength, so mighty in power, not a single one is missing. How can you say, tribe of Leah and Rachel and Jacob, my destiny is hidden from Yahweh, my rights are ignored by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? Yahweh is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. This God does not faint or grow weary, with a depth of understanding that is unsearchable. God gives strength to the weary and empowers the powerless. Young women may grow tired and weary. Young men may stumble and fall. But those who wait for Yahweh find a renewed power. They soar on eagle's wings. They run and don't get weary. They walk and never tire. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us read together selected verses from the 147th Psalm. Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor God with praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem and gathers the exiles of Israel. The Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. The Lord counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to God's wisdom. The Lord lifts up the lowly but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music upon the harp to our God, who covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth, making grass to grow upon the mountains. God provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they cry. God is not impressed by the might of a horse and has no pleasure in the speed of a runner, but finds pleasure in those who fear the Lord, in those who await God's steadfast love. Hallelujah.
A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians, the 9th chapter. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, Lord and Savior, open now your saving word.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now, Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Hello, I'm Sarah Sedlacek, and here with me today is Nolan Sedlacek, and we are going to do the children's sermon. Nolan, what is this?
That is a phone.
A phone. And a lot of people have these. As you probably know, it has a battery built inside that has to be recharged. You can't do much with it once the battery runs out. What do you have of yours that needs to be recharged?
My iPad, my Nintendo.
And do you get upset if it runs out of batteries?
Yeah,
okay. People need to recharge their batteries too. We work and we play hard, and if we don't get enough rest, pretty soon we just don't have enough energy to do the things we need to do. So just kind of like at night, we have to go to sleep. And so we kind of power down. Even Jesus had to recharge. Today we'll learn how he did that. As you listen to what happened, use your arms to tell how charged you think Jesus' battery is. So go ahead and stand up and put your arms up. And as you listen to the story, if you think Jesus' battery is going down, you put your arms down. If you think Jesus' battery is going up, put your arms up. Okay? You ready? All right. Jesus traveled all around Galilee, preaching, driving out demons, and healing people. One day, Jesus and some of his disciples went to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was there in her bed with a fever, and Jesus took her by the hand and helped her up. All at once, the fever left her, and she began to prepare a meal for everyone. That evening, many people came to Jesus to be healed of all sorts of diseases, and the whole town gathered at the door to watch. That must have been a long day. So then Jesus got up before sunrise the next morning and found a quiet place to pray and recharge his spirit. When Simon and the others woke up, they found him and said, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus had to recharge his batteries and was ready to go. He said to them, "Let's go to the other towns and villages so I can preach to them. That's what I came to do." So they traveled throughout the region of Galilee, and Jesus preached in synagogues and healed people and cast out demons. All right, so where's Jesus' battery right now?
Right here.
It's right there? Okay. If Jesus thought it was important to him to recharge his spiritual battery, it's important for us to do that too. That's why we should spend time in prayer every day and come to church every week. So where do you feel like your battery's at right now?
Kind of like right here.
Okay, why is your battery there?
Because I'm kind of tired. I went to school for 7 hours. We did spelling. I had a math test. I had recess. I had music, and yeah.
All right, so you're getting ready to go to bed soon to recharge your batteries. But before you do, let's say a prayer. All right, bow your head and pray. You can sit back down here with me, okay? Bow your head and pray. God, help us to remember that just as our bodies must be renewed by proper rest, our spirit must be renewed by spending time with you in prayer, Bible study, and worship. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you, Nolan.
Grace and peace to you this day, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Sometime back, I received an email that shared quotes of young children as they learned the language of the faith. It's one of those emails that makes the rounds, so some of you may have seen it or one similar to it. Here are a few examples of what was contained in the one sent to me. A three-year-old named Reese begins the Lord's Prayer this way. Our Father, who does art in heaven, Harold is his name. If Moses only knew. Another three-year-old by the name of Caitlin has been saying the Lord's Prayer each night at bedtime. Her mother would recite a line of the prayer, and then Caitlin would repeat it. One night, Caitlin decided to do it all on her own. Her mother listened with pride as her daughter carefully said each line perfectly, that is, until she got to the end. Lead us not into temptation, she prayed, but deliver us some email. One particular four-year-old had some difficulty with another part of the prayer. And forgive us our trash baskets, he recited, as we forgive those who put trash in our baskets. Not so far off the mark when you think about it. A Sunday school class was studying the Ten Commandments. They were ready to discuss the last one. The teacher asked if anyone could tell her what it was. One young girl raised her hand, stood tall, and quoted, "Thou shalt not take the covers off thy neighbor's wife." Also, pretty true. As entertaining as these quotes from these children are, there is another value I find as I listen to what they are saying. These are windows into how we learn the faith and seek to incorporate it into our living. These young children are encountering words and concepts that are unfamiliar to their world, and they are in a process of trying to make sense of them through words and concepts they do know. Faith development is a process of taking these concepts that have been handed down to us and bringing them to bear in our living and having them make sense in our world of experience. This is just as much true for the oldest adult among us as it is for the youngest child. The gospel reading we hear from Mark this day is part of a larger whole, which some interpreters like to call the gospel writer's attempt at depicting a typical day in the life of Jesus. It begins several verses before what we have heard. It begins on a Saturday morning in the village of Capernaum. As Saturday is the Jewish Sabbath, Jesus naturally begins the day by going to synagogue with his disciples. There he teaches, and the whole assembly is amazed by the authority with which he speaks. As he leaves, he is met by a man with an unclean spirit. Jesus exorcises the demon, and the man goes on his way. Having spent the morning in worship, Jesus then goes to the home of one of his disciples, Simon Peter. There, he encounters Peter's ailing mother-in-law, and he heals her. He spends the rest of the afternoon there, being served by this woman he has healed. By the time evening arrives, Peter's front yard has become filled with the entire population of the town. They have heard of the events of this day and have brought all kinds of people who are sick or possessed. Jesus continues to heal and exorcise demons well into the night. Very early the next day, long before sunrise, Jesus leaves his friends in order to be alone. He finds a deserted place and enters into dialogue with the Father in prayer. His disciples track him down, though, and interrupt him, trying to compel him to come back to Capernaum. Jesus has a different set of marching orders, however, ones he understands as his calling from God. He refuses to return with them and instead goes on to neighboring towns and villages. There he continues to preach and teach, heal and expel demons, and even cleanses a person who has leprosy, enabling this person once again to be a part of the community. So it seemed to go for Jesus. When he was not engaged in the more extraordinary moments of his life, like appearing before priests, kings, and Roman governors, or clearing out money changers in the temple, or being on trial for his life, the typical day for Jesus was all about preaching and teaching, healing and exercising, not exercising, but exorcising, and restoring people's dignity and place in the community. The challenge for me in all of this is to think about how a typical day of Jesus compares to a typical day of my own. I know that being a Christian means following in the way of Jesus. But how do I make sense of the way that is described here in this gospel? How do I incorporate what he does in his life with what I do in mine? Obviously, a typical day in my life doesn't look much like what I've just described regarding Jesus. I guess that would probably be true of all of us. Going to work, going to school, shopping for the family, taking care of the bills, carting kids to their various activities, worrying about the economy and the politics of the day. With all these tasks and sundry others facing us each day, where is there time for proclaiming the good news, teaching, healing, and praying, and restoring people in order for them to be part of the community once again? Time is not the only issue here. Who among us feels competent to be able to live our lives the way Jesus lived his? Who among us can speak with his authority? Who can act with his power? Yet this is precisely what Jesus calls us to do. Just as God sent him out to do these things, he now sends us out as his disciples and his ambassadors. He calls us to live in his way and carry on the work he began. Much like children working to incorporate the language of faith into their vocabularies, we are being called to incorporate the life of faith into the daily living of our lives. The challenge before us is to understand in the things we do each day, in whatever circumstances we are in, these are the opportunities to say a word of good news. These are the times when there are people who are hurting that we may comfort. These are the times when those who feel left out and at odds with the world, they are there that we may help feel part of the community once again. And God is always available to us in prayer and is there for us wherever we are. This day in the life of Jesus we read in the Gospel of Mark is meant to be a model. It is a model for us in terms of how we go about our daily living, a model for how we go to work each day, how we go to school each day, how we care for one another each day in our families and in our communities. It is a model showing how we are a part of God's life and how God seeks to be a part of ours. In this sense, a typical day for us becomes anything but typical, especially if we mean by typical that which is mundane and uneventful. Each day is the opportunity we have to know the presence and power of God. Each day is the opportunity we have to work for wholeness and healing in our world. Each day is the opportunity we have for sharing the goodness of God's grace. The gospel this day calls us to think about how we might lay hold of these opportunities in the things we do every day.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. for the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God, for creation, for insects in the grass, clouds on the mountaintops, for cattle and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God, for the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, and CEOs, for international health organizations, that in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God, for all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you. In the midst of a global crisis, we look to you for strength, hope, and help in fighting the coronavirus pandemic. We pray for those stricken with this disease and those who are treating them, for those mourning the loss of life and those facing death, and for those who urgently work to find effective treatments for cure. We lift up to you those in our faith community needing your care. Rick, Cindy, Chris, Andy, Dave N., Dave S., Felicia, Sarah, Sylvia, Myrene, Pama, Lynn Ann, Kira, Reed, Dorothy, D., and those we name aloud or silently in our hearts. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God, for this congregation, for outreach and social ministries centered here, for parish nurses and visitors, for ministries of companionship and support, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God, in thanksgiving for the faithful departed, who were called by name and now rest from their labors, that their lives serve as witnesses to the goodness of God, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
Let us now confess our sins to God and hear God's words of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us now share the peace with those who may be worshiping with us today. God's peace.
God's peace.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Beloved, here is bread, here is wine, here is Jesus. Come and be fed. All are welcome. And now let us commune ourselves with these words. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
This is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
And this is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. Having now been fed as God's people, let us receive God's blessing. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace.
Amen.
Amen. And now let us pray together. Christ Jesus, at this table we have feasted on your very life and are strengthened for our journey. Send us forth from this banquet, nourished in body and in spirit, to proclaim your good news and serve others in your name. Amen. God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
In today's gospel text, Jesus retreats to be in prayer in a deserted place after performing many acts of healing. The disciples had to search for him, and when being found, Jesus, instead of going back to where they were, calls the disciples to follow him into what lies ahead. We too are called to follow Jesus into what lies ahead for us, being a people called to incorporate God's life into our daily living. And we do this with the promise that Jesus will be with us. Living and acting as God's people, go in peace and serve our Lord. Thanks be to God.